Can everyone hear me well? Good. Thank you. This is a little bit about me. We're going to go through these. We have about 80 slides, and we have about 50 minutes, so we're going to go through many of these slides quickly. I have been involved in printing, actually it says here, over 20 years. It is closer to 30 years. I write and report on digital printing and digital fabrication issues. I would like to talk a little bit about my colleague Patrice. I met Patrice in June of 1996. I was investigating digital printing on textiles, particularly garment printing at the time. And I visited with Patrice at his operations for Emblem and discovered a printing system that he developed, and it was the first printing system, digital printing system for decorating garments. And it was very eye-opening. But one of the wonderful things that I discovered then is Patrice's candor and honesty about the whole process. He offered me a great deal of detailed information, as well as essentially criticizing some of the choices that were made in the development, and also suggested routes to the future. He had his honesty, his commitment to his science was really quite compelling. But another aspect of Patrice that I want to mention is his commitment to essentially transfer, to move the information on, to mentor other people. He and his wife just completed over a year ago, they were 2 years in Africa teaching students in Africa physics, chemistry, and mathematics. And I want to challenge everyone here, because the future of digital fabrication, as well as other scientific endeavors, is going to require a lot of people who are teachers. And I think everybody in this room right now is potentially a teacher, certainly a mentor. Everyone in this room, I am sure, has had mentors who have inspired them, and that's why you're sitting here today. And so, as part of our talk on digital fabrication and showing you the different technologies that are out there, what we are doing today is presenting you a catalog of this is what we know about right now. But also, we're presenting you an opportunity. And the opportunity is for you to receive regular updates. And this is free of charge. There's nothing, we're not selling you anything here. But what we will be doing is constantly monitoring the technologies and keeping you apprised of new developments. Most of the talks that are given here are very narrow. They are focused on particular issues, particular aspects of our science. What we are doing is giving you a very broad view, giving you something that tends to be more encyclopedic. Well, obviously, we're going to have to move fairly fast through these slides. So we want to offer you copies of this. We will either send this to you, or you will be able to download it from our website. So afterwards, if you would like to give me your card, we will send it to you. You will not receive any emails that you don't want to receive. But we would be sending you a copy of this. You could also opt in to receive our updates in our newsletters. So what our company does is to investigate essentially digital fabrication and digital print technology. And the distinction that we make between what is print is essentially we define as decoration, and fabrication, digital fabrication, we define as that which performs a function. But something that I want to, we are focused also on markets, and we're focused on applications, because our technology is meaningless without applications, totally irrelevant, useless. I have seen much technology that goes absolutely nowhere, that sits on a shelf, because there is no marketable application for it. So we are focused on also discovering what those markets are. So discerning also market patterns is critical to our operation. We are constantly looking at demographics. We're constantly looking at census data, because essentially your customers are people. So our catalog. Today we're going to also focus you on a bit of history, and also the relationship of science and the technology of digital fabrication to society. We'll give you a very brief view of something I'm sure you all know, the origins of subtractive and additive digital fabrication. We'll give you the broad view, and then we will also talk about what does it all mean, and what does it all mean for society. Today, 54 years ago today, Yuri Gagarin became the first, is that him calling now? I wonder. became the first human to orbit the planet Earth. Where were you 54 years ago? There's Yuri. Less than 12 years later, humans walked on Earth's moon. A rather dramatic accomplishment, an enormous amount of effort being focused and channeled to accomplish this task. There we are. But about 35,000 years ago, probably before most of us were born, we see at the caves in Lascaux and also in the south of France, and that's, by the way, why Patrice is here to talk today. Not that he was one of the ones who did the paintings on the in the past, but he is looking at trying to help in the efforts in preserving these and also creating replicas of these. There is right now at Lascaux, since Lascaux itself was closed because unfortunately our human breathing has a profound negative effect on these paintings. Lascaux 2 was created, which recreated, and this was done by hand, the actual cave. At Chavet, there is another one of the caves of southern France. The effort is now being done to recreate that and to use digital print and fabrication methods. Patrice has consulted on that and will be speaking a bit about that. So what part of this issue here today is I want to really impress upon you the importance that you have, and actually in a way, I hate to be moralistic about this, but the responsibility that you all have to mentor other people. You know, you are experts in your particular areas. You are people who are, and many of you are doing this already, but there is a need for this technology to make the type of leap that human beings did from Yuri Gagarin up to landing on the moon. That type of accelerated leap is going to require that we have more people than are currently trained to do the job. And you're the guys to do the job. You're the guys to train other people, to help other people learn these skills. So we want to encourage that, and maybe even say that might be a matter of your social responsibility. The other problem that we have, and we'll look at, is that we're going from being hunter-gatherers to being, according to the UN, as of the end of this month, 7 billion people on this planet. Now, the US Census Bureau says it's not going to happen until March of 2012, but give or take a month or two. 7 billion, and then we go to 8 billion and 9 billion, and we'll talk about that later. And how do we provide jobs? How do we provide wherewithal for these populations? And what is the role of digital fabrication in that? So we are going to be looking at a bit and understanding and accepting the responsibility that comes with this human history from that takes us and connects us from the cave paintings to our current day and our involvements in this robotic activity. We're dealing in a milieu of capitalism, and capitalism has both great strengths and great weaknesses. And we're now at a point where we're seeing some of the great weaknesses. And for our technology to move forward, we're going to need wherewithal. We're going to need resources, and the economy is going to have to generate them. And we'll discuss a bit how does that come about. We also have the challenge of a warming planet. And frankly, digital fabrication really does have the can assist in limiting the warming that occurs on this planet. Mr. Seiki, who just introduced us, is working on projects for creating photovoltaics. Others in this room are doing the same. We are looking at ways to stop burning fossil fuels, and our methods, our technology is helping to accomplish that. Digital fabrication is being touted as the next big thing, but we've had a lot of next big things in our own lifetime, including things like nuclear energy, we have seen that's a two-edged sword. It can work for us or against us, and we have to decide how can we do this for good rather than doing it for ill with digital fabrication. Now, most of you here have recognized this, and you are now, because of your experience having looked through a telescope to see this, you are part of a chain that takes you back to the 1600s, and a gentleman, you see the gentleman? He was supposedly doing this in Padua at the time, but, and there he is, Galileo Galilei. How many here in this room looked through a telescope and observed the moons of Jupiter? You know what's? I noticed that most of the people who just did that were a little on the older side, and the younger people. But anyone who has looked through a telescope and has observed the heavens has a direct connection to that man, because he was the first one to do it. So there's this long chain of people who now better understand the world our home, and understand also. That this was the man who came up with the conclusive proof from his study of the phases of Venus that Ptolemy was wrong and Copernicus was right. Of course, that landed him under house arrest because he was a very witty and offended the Pope. But necessary ingredients. Well, I'm getting back to training and skills, and you will hear this a number of times throughout this talk. History and knowledge-based company cultures. There are companies that are almost anti-intellectual, and certainly some that are anti-science. These are not ones that are going to be part of the future. Challenge. Challenge is at the root of meaning. Everyone in this room is here because you've challenged yourself at some point during your lives. You've done that. You've challenged yourself, and here you are. This is using a greater potential energy to get here. You're not flowing downstream. You worked very hard to be sitting in this room. And what gives us our joy, our passion? I was speaking to one of our colleagues yesterday, and we were talking about a subject that most people on this planet would think we were crazy to be talking about. But he was speaking about, we were talking about nanoscale, and he was speaking about it with passion, with great passion. And his work gives him great joy, the joie de vivre. Now, I'm going to ask you for another raising of hands. How many here in this room could say that they are passionate about their work? I'm not going to ask those who are not passionate to raise your hand. But is that part of what makes what you do important? That makes it relevant? Of course. And this is what, that passion is what you have to communicate to other people, to younger people, to people you're going to mentor. We need applications that satisfy markets, that meet market demands, not just neat technologies. Neat technologies are great, but unless they have applications, they're going nowhere. And you're going to need resources and effective models, and that magic ingredient, money. And of course, there we go back to our economy and the state we're in right now. And you need enough money to do this job. And then you're going to need marketing and sales to essentially maintain it. So you're going to be looking for customers with expendable income. Who has the money? Well, one group that has some money are governments. And in fact, governments have been very generous to our industry and have helped to sustain it. Also, they have business to do that is going to need the tools that you're making. The origins. Subtractive technology, John Parson and Frank Stolen were the key developers. They also combined their efforts with MIT and IBM to essentially bring about CNC type technology, which is virtually taking over a lot of our manufacturing processes. And all of those CNC processes require somebody or require a file, an STL file usually, but they require a file that is generated by somebody who knows how to operate CAD, computer-aided design. There are right now about variously estimated between 700,000 and 1 million CAD operators in the world. That's just about enough to cover activities we currently have. So when we talk about new activities involving digital printing and involving the additive technologies, we're going to need more people. We're going to need schools teaching people how to design and how to generate, how to work in CAD and how to generate these files. Or another alternative to that is that we have new programming and new methods that will allow people on a layperson without this type of training to be able to direct equipment. And of course, some of that is in development right now. So here we have stereolithography. Chuck Hull, of course, is legendary in the field as one of the founders of 3D systems, certainly a leader. Probably the leader in digital fabrication manufacture. And there's the first system. Also, Dr. Carl Deckard of Texas was also key in the development of selective laser sintering. We are using certain production criteria, and we are in the process right now of reviewing all of the technologies that are out there. And this is one of the things that will be available to you, again, free of charge, where we are essentially evaluating all of the technologies based on these parameters. So that you can be able to choose, when you are undertaking a project, you're able to choose what is the most relevant technology to select. We have also seen this, what I call the production scale, going from prototype models through functional models, and many of you, of course, have been generating all of this, all the way up to mass production. And of course, these distinctions will also be included in the charting. These are some of the these are all of the technologies that are involved in digital fabrication. We are discovering new technologies virtually every day and seeing new technologies. There are technologies probably that some of you in this audience are working on and developing, well, some of which you may not be able to talk about, and some of which are not on this chart that you can talk about. When you can talk about them, we would be very appreciative because we will help disseminate information about your technology to the rest of your colleagues and also to the population in general. So these are some of the technologies we're going to be taking some quick looks at because we have a limited amount of time. But a more detailed version of our presentation will be available to all of you if you so care to receive it. I've divided digital fabrication into what these are seven categories. You might also add an eighth category, particularly in the bio area. But this is focusing mostly on the method of applying the particular material. And so we have what I would call the stereolithography-like technologies, the laser sintering and melting technologies, the e-beam technologies, the ultrasonic welding technologies, 3D inkjet, and other fluid types of deposition technologies, wire and extruding technologies, and then the hybrids, the additive and subtractive. I'm sure that we could take the list and divide it in some different ways. But this is one that we are using, and our charting is using this for just listing things in categories. So rather than having this mass that you have some distinction from which you can make judgments. These are some of the materials that are currently used. Again, I've tried to be all-inclusive here, but frankly, there are things that are going on that there are in some of the skunk works in which many of you toil that are not on this list. When you can make that information public, when you can expand the range of what it is that you can make and that you can do and that you can project to the rest of the community and to the world, please let us know, because we can help you to get that word out. These are some of the industries right now, and these are the ones that we're currently listing. But again, we might not be all inclusive. And if you can add some to this, please, please do. This is a roadmap for organic and printed electronic applications coming from the OEA. And as you can see, this is charting progress, and this is an attempt to put a time frame on it. But here we see organic photovoltaics. How many here are working on photovoltaics? Okay, how about flexible displays? OLED? Okay, same sort of thing. RFID tags. Printed memory, printed batteries. A little bit on batteries. Okay, we've got to work on batteries. Sensors. Okay. What you're seeing here is that, there's some pretty good activity here. You guys are all involved in this, and obviously this is This is the future. This is a map that someone else basically created, but I think it does give a fairly accurate picture of where things are going and where technology is going. This is some of the categories that we'll be covering. This is some of the format that we'll be using, and here I'm just using the general categories of particular types, but and each of those subject areas will have these types of charts. Stereolithography. Now, one of the things that 3D Systems asserts is that 75% of additive digital fabrication uses SLA technology. Well, that was actually about a year and a half ago. I think right now the SLA portion is beginning to shrink because other technologies are beginning to take over. But let me, how many here have worked with stereolithography? Okay, so a lot of you have not, because stereolithography being it is currently the major way in which digital fabrication is executed. And so this technology is was one of the first technologies. And essentially what you're using is a laser to essentially cure photopolymers that are in a bath and you raise it. It's fairly simple, straightforward type of technology. And it does work. And we have, these are a series of systems that are out there that are using this technology. It's also used, I mentioned there, wax. Jewelers use this technology and also another type of inkjet technology from Solidscape, which is now owned by Stratasys. These are some of the limitations. One of the big limitations here is that it's slow. The other, for some of the stereolithography, the earlier versions of stereolithography, is your deposition level is greater than 30 microns. It's actually usually greater than, it's around 100 microns. The problem with that is that you can see it. You can see the artifact. And I will mention here that 30 microns is a critical dimension because it's the dimension below which you don't see the artifact and above which you do. So in order to make something that you're not having to finish in some other way, because many of what often happens with stereolithography and a number of the other technologies we're talking about is you have to go back in and finish it, or you combine it with some sort of subtractive method to do finishing on the technology. Microstereolithography, however, is an advance that is mostly in university labs right now, but this can take the refinement down to really in the range of about 1 to 10 microns. And then also for developing lenses, an interesting film microstereolithography, and the group at Georgia Tech, and Georgia Tech is working on all sorts of things, but Georgia Tech also has done some very interesting study on this. And these are some of the actual products that are out in the market using the microstereolithography. Huntsman introduced a new technology, their Digitalis technology, which is quite interesting. It is basically a type of stereolithography, but what it does is to create multi-points, many points, up to 40,000 pixels across a surface, and its maximum XY resolutions are in the 10 micron level, but its thickness is about 50, its layer thickness is about 50 microns. It's a manufacturing method instead of a prototyping method. This is really a manufacturing. You can manufacture many items, and it has a larger build area And there's a video online, just go to Huntsman Digitalis and you can see this blazing machine make yellow roses. film transfer image was something that 3D Systems developed and is in their V-Flash machine. The big advantage of this is that it's a $10,000 machine, so it's affordable. It doesn't pass the 30 micron layer rule, but it is fine for hobbyist and prototype development. And again, price points, because what has to happen with this technology is the price points have to go down. And we see some applications here. If you need a skull from, if you want a skull from the times that go back to when we were doing our cave paintings, you can manufacture those with this. Selective laser sintering, a technology where instead of working with polymers, you can not only work with polymers with selective laser sintering, you can also work with metals and some ceramic type surfaces. Lots of applications. The sintering is using a CO2 laser, so relatively low energy. You can get with a selective laser, you can approach the 30 micron. You can actually go between about 20 to 100 microns. Selective laser melting, the sintering you can approach, the laser melting you can actually get from between 20 to 100 microns. Selective laser melting is being used for in dental work, in aerospace, really a wide range of an orthopedic replacement hips and replacement knees are manufactured this way. Laser engineered net shaping, another technology which is again using high intensity fiber laser light, and this is focused directly through the printhead to sinter essentially metals that are combined actually at the printhead point. But again, this is also using a controlled atmosphere where oxygen is eliminated so as to eliminate the oxidation that can occur with metal. Of all of the technologies I've mentioned so far, how many here are working with those technologies? Okay. How many want to work with those technologies? Okay. This technology is being used it's being used for both repair and for fabricating of, and again, being used in the defense and aerospace. When we ask the question, where is the money? Well, that's where a lot of the money is, and that's where a lot of things are being done there. Laser cladding is really almost virtually identical to sinter lasered melting. I include it here because the industry, there are very, very slight differences. Diffuse deposition modeling, this is where Stratasys comes to the fore, but also this is where a lot of the home fabrication units are using this technology, where you take a coil of some polymeric material and you essentially melt it and deposit it. And a lot of plastics can be used. More sophisticated plastics are being used on the more expensive machines, but using polylactic acid and ABS can be done with some devices that are in the $1,000 to $2,000 range. And these are being used. And I also want to mention, this is really one of the opportunities for training. I know people who own these devices, and they get very excited about their abilities to make replacement parts for things. Now, they have fairly small build areas, but they were also used, the Stratasys Fortis system, which is a more sophisticated industrial version of this, was used in the modeling for the Bell helicopter systems and some other devices. So this is, you have systems from Bits from Bytes, an English company that has gotten its devices into schools. And so a lot of schools in around the world right now have these systems and are teaching their students. And we have to really promote this, help this process along. There's also Neil Gershenfeld, a number of years ago, spoke to this group. And he spoke on the fab labs that are being set up around the world, where essentially people in communities can make things digitally, and also in the process learn CAD programming and controlling computer and doing computer-aided design and computer-aided manufacture. There's a company in Brooklyn, New York that makes the MakerBot. I don't know. So how many of you have these types of devices that you play with? I'm jealous. Are they fun? This is part of what's going to make this move forward. I hate to say it, is fun. It's got to be fun. It's got to inspire passion. It's got to get people dreaming about what they can do, their possibilities. I really do want an electron beam, but electron beams are very expensive. So this is where governments and foundations and universities and very well-heeled corporations get to play. But electron beams have very strong capabilities, and it also can do things a lot faster. So when we start looking at production, we're looking at electron beams. And NASA developed an electron beam system, their EBF3, electron beam freeform fabrication. Very exciting development. And this is also being commercialized by a company that sells welding equipment and supplies in Chicago. We're back in space again, this is actually not on the space shuttle. This was the creation of zero gravity in a 747. What they were doing was testing E-beam F3 under those conditions. Inkjet. Inkjet is probably going to be, inkjet and deposition techniques like inkjet are probably going to be the major future. Mr. Seiki, who introduced me today, of course, is working for a company that makes great inkjets, and they're also involved right now in printing circuits. I also mentioned a few other companies here, Fujifilm, Dymatics, Trident, Ricoh, some people are using the Xerox Tektronix heads also for digital fabrication applications. The Israeli firm Objet has been a real leader in using this technology and for manufacture. Robocasting was developed again by the U.S. government robocasting really is a form a type of inkjet-like technology. Here we get into the hybrid technologies, and the hybrid technologies offer the opportunity to use digital fabrication to essentially assemble things. To really take the whole assembly process and to automate it. Another technology that's also a hybrid that uses both uses the lamination of usually paper and plastic, thin plastic type films, laminating and then cutting those cutting them with a laser, or it can also be done simply with a knife object. But the products on the market use a laser. Solid ground curing is a technology. And I am including here, even though the company that had used it failed. And this is a failure because, the complexity of the technology, but also the level of waste that the technology produces. So we have to be looking at our waste. This technology, the IP for this technology is owned by Objet now. Ultrasonic consolidation, also known as ultrasonic additive manufacturing, was something that was invented in Wisconsin, the neighboring state. But a lot of the development with it was done at the Edison Welding Institute in Columbus, Ohio, which is I don't know, how many here have been to the Edison Welding Institute? I would urge you all to go there. It's an amazing place near Ohio State University where a lot of this technology development on a gross scale is being done. And they are working on the very high power ultrasonic with the folks in Wisconsin, Solidica. And these ultrasonic has a big advantage in manufacturing, because what ultrasonic allows you to do is to not worry about temperature, whereas, you know, lasers and electron beams can get a little hot. So if you're trying to assemble things and put insert chips into a production process, ultrasonic does have some advantages in that regard. There's also cold metal transfer. This is almost like a welding type of technique. But it's a relatively low energy and can be used assembly. Integrated or precision extrusion deposition is being used a lot in to build lattices and structures for bio applications. And it was developed and patented by Drexel University in Philadelphia. And we see, it requires cooling to be truly successful in depositing certain types of biopolymers that are sensitive. Near field electrospinning. Will this ever end? This whole list. It's a long list, and there's more that's being added and added every day. You're going to be able to have this available to you, so I am not going to go into the nitty-gritty here. And there's also the low voltage version of this. And you see, we give credit to the inventors of this technology. Biofabrication, we could go on in great length, but here you have some of the key developers. I think Dr. Atala spoke to our group in the past, and these are truly the pioneers, the innovators. Who here is working in bio? Any? Okay, because bio certainly is a very, very exciting area, and we're going to see real growth there. There's also, though, real danger there. Now, Wake Forest, here's some of their developments. They're currently printing skin. They have skin is commercially viable. A lot of, you know, making organs is not commercially, probably won't be commercially viable or possible for some time, even though there is the group that has made a rat's heart. But here we're dealing with inkjet printing of skin. This is a system that was developed at Wake Forest. But also, people, this is, Monolite is being done in Britain, where you can actually build larger things, much larger things. And so your inkjet-like device that's basically extruding, spitting out cement-like material, sandstone, dust, and inorganic magnesium-based binders, That's happening. It's also happening in California, where it is possible that we can take this technology and digitally control whatever it is that we make. As from the very large to the very small, this is being done AIST in technology being developed by SIJ technology in Japan. These, I'm going to go through these very rapidly. These give you a bunch of companies. I'm now going to hand the podium over to Patrice.
Yes. In fact, why we make the continuation between the solution time and what we are capable to do is because we have to think about that we knew. Where is the. Okay, yes. Thank you. We have new tools now, and I am working presently on projects in order to reproduce the Chauvet cave, which is beside where I am living in Ardèche. And at the University of Grenoble, we are trying to know and to find new tools as the ancient people do 35,000 years ago, to try the right tools in order to represent the images. And it's something that is very important to see if with 3D fabrication, using also new ways in order to manipulate some objects, we are capable with haptic tool, for instance, to be able to go in a new wave of manufacturing. And why it's a good challenge, as Vince told you, how to have the opportunity to significantly change the way we work with others. And sorry, I'm not doing this then. Okay. In a more collaborative ways, that says that 3D digital fabrication, now we are all over the world, and we have to use more direct ways. This is a challenge and the opportunities that our technology provide us. Working in a more collaborative way will enable men and women around the world to learn and benefit from working together. We should not forget the goal of our work to serve our communities and mankind in a manner that we will not pollute our environment. And I think that we can, what is very important is every time we have a vision or we are using technology, we have to have a vision to be, to serve mankind. And, but serve mankind is also to be involved in the economy. And I will let you, Vince, to continue a little bit about the last point of this presentation.
One of the things that we're faced with right now is the inherent instability of, which is a flaw of capitalism. Now, I'm a capitalist. I've been CEO of a publicly traded company. I have, run these things. But I also know that inherent to the system, and we've seen it firsthand. We've seen them since late 2007, 2008. We saw the collapse of our economy. And we're still digging through it. And that will impact us. Now, we are fortunate because the technology that we're dealing with actually speaks to the future. And it speaks to a future. We actually can be part of the solution. But of course, Mr. Bernanke, just last week, was saying that the United States is in basically a national crisis. And it's because there are so many workers, long-term workers, out of work, and that the economy is in risk, at risk of suffering long-term as well as short-term. The other thing is that the population is increasing. As I mentioned before, by 2027, we're up to 8 billion. By 2046, 9 billion people. How are we going to supply, how are we going to have careers like you have for all of these people, or for a significant part of them, enough at least to sustain an economy. Digital fabrication will eliminate assembly and manual fabrication jobs and careers. That is going to happen. There is an economic driver to do that. And also, the National Center for Manufacturing Science projects that 98% of manufactured products will be digitally designed and fabricated by 2020. Who agrees with that? Who agrees with that? Who disagrees with that? Okay, that's I asked this question of a bunch of people, and what this, of course, when we say digitally, we're including subtractive in the manufacturing process as well as additive, so it's not all additive. Projected digital fabrication, however, right now we don't have the people. This is what we don't have the people who are trained. There is, one of my colleagues mentioned that at Cambridge has a Cambridge University, and in the Cambridge area there is a job posting, and most of the jobs are not getting filled because there aren't the people there with the skills. So we have to fill that gap. And you can have an effect. The opportunities. Not only the low-cost 3D manufacturing, this is a way in which we can start getting people trained, getting them interested. Also, as I mentioned, the fab labs, I think, are a great idea and are and getting it into schools. This is a way in which we have to do this in order for this technology, all of those technologies that we talked about, for them to become a reality. Of course, the things that you're making, photovoltaics, all of these other opportunities, they are there, you know what they are. Digital technology will both complement as well as replace some of the traditional methods of fabrication. Increasingly, it will replace. Digital fabrication can bring also fabrication closer to market, which will help to minimize our use of greenhouse gases. Digital fabrication also is able to bring new routes to market. We need these things. I want to thank you very much for listening to holding up between this long litany of technologies. But the other thing is that this is a tool. It's available to you. It's a tool for you to just, it's a reference tool, to be able to understand, at least have some reference points, this opens the door to a lot of those technologies that you may not have been aware of or may not have worked with. And please, it's available to you. Give us a card. We will send you, you will not be spammed. We go through a service that prevents us from spamming, so it's a totally legitimate application. And it's just a service. If you want this and our newsletter, it's available to you free of charge. I want to thank you very much. And I think we're probably running a little bit over, but if anybody does have questions, we will be available. So thank you. How do we do?